Hey scholars, welcome to chapter 14 of AP Environmental Science, Geology and Non-Renewable Minerals. So this week we're going to talk a little bit more about the geology section of AP Environmental Science, and that's what we're going to start with today. You guys took a look at a core case study on environmental effects of gold mining, and you guys looked at the main gold producers in the world, South Africa, Australia, the US even, and Canada, and you looked at the harmful effects that played a role in that extracting of gold itself. And obviously we'll use cyanide, which is extremely toxic to birds, animals, to mammals, specifically us. And in 2000, there was a collapse of a dam retaining a cyanide leach pond that overflowed and then got into the drinking water, had impacts on not only organisms around that area, but even downstream because of the cyanide in that water system. All right, so let's take a look at 14.1. So this is going to be a little bit of a review over earth science stuff, but what are the earth's major geological processes and hazards? And we're going to start with what is geology? And basically it is the study of the non-living things on earth, really. There are three major concentration zones of the earth, and obviously you hopefully remember this one, the core, which is very hot, solid, dense material in the middle of the earth. The mantle, which is also solid, it also has a thin layer on the outside of the mantle, which is called the asthenosphere, which is like a soft plastic-like material. It's a little bit softer than the solid that makes up most of the mantle. And the crust, which actually have two different types of crust, the continental crust, which is under the continents, obviously what we're standing on right now, and then the oceanic crust, which is 71% of the crust, which has water above it, specifically oceans. So those are our two main types of crusts. We're going to do a lab this week too, which will feature all these different types of shifts and plates and boundaries. But major features of the Earth's crust and upper mantle, obviously the core doesn't show here, but here's the mantle. The asthenosphere specifically, so kind of very plasticky-like in nature. Then you have your crust. Here's the continental crust, and then this doesn't show you, but would be the oceanic crust over here. As these things, you can see that the motion of the plates, in this area right here, they're separating. They're kind of pulling apart from them. We're going to come back and talk about this in a second, but it's forming a couple of different things called a ridge, and then on the sides of that, the abyssal hills, abyssal floor, and then we'll talk about this area too. We'll come back to that in a second as well. So if you notice back in this previous picture I'm going to go back to, there are convection cells, just like you saw in the atmosphere. Which basically talk, you know, there's currents, they move in a consistent rate and consistent flow in that direction. So there are convection cells underneath your feet as well as above you in the atmosphere. Kind of crazy to think about, constant motion. And what they're moving are these things called tectonic plates, and you've heard of this before, plate tectonics or whatever. And then the lithosphere, obviously, that's all what you're walking on. What all the crust, all that stuff is lithosphere, all that goes into that part of environmental science. So we're going to look at the boundaries. Obviously, there's plates on us. You know what plates are. They're moving underneath us because of this flow or this flow of the mantle. And what's happening is it's causing three different types of boundaries. That plates, there's many different plates. We'll talk about those in a little bit. But there's three major specific plate boundaries. The first one, pretty easy, divergent. Diverge means to go separate ways. So divergent plates, basically plates that are literally moving away from one another, or moving away from one another. And the magma will flow up through that, those plates as it moves away. And that's how oceanic ridges are created. And we'll take a look back on our screen here. This is obviously where we have two diverging, and this ridge, that magma flowing up through the mantle, is actually forming that ridge right along there. So that's just one example. The next one is the convergent. When you converge, you're coming together. So these are just plates moving toward one another, going to one another. And this happens, there's some things that could happen here. One of those happens is called subduction, where literally one plate is more dense than the other. And when that occurs, one either moves up or one goes down. So a subduction is the more dense plate goes under, density sinks. So the thicker, the more dense plate with more mass and materials will literally go underneath or subdue underneath, and the other plate will go rise above it. And that's what you're seeing here. And this plate right here, this is a subduction zone where two plates literally are coming together. This one right here and this one right here. And one of them is more dense, would be this one, and it's subduing. Now notice which one is more dense. The more dense one is actually usually the oceanic, which is kind of crazy to think about. So subduction zone area was actually where the collision is occurring, and actually this is how trenches formed. You can see there's a trench kind of forming right there. You can see there's a trench line forming all along that plate boundary. And the last one is called a transform fault. Kind of a weird one. There's lots of these all over, especially the U.S. But I don't think it has a good picture of a transform fault on there. Nope, no picture of that one. But that's basically where literally two plates are not, one of them is not more dense. They're basically at the same density, but they're actually sliding past one another, kind of slipping a little bit like this, going this direction, putting pressure and sliding. And the best example of this is out in California. The San Andreas Fault is a transform fault. And this is what a transform fault will look like. This is the San Andreas Fault. You can see it is kind of making a ridge, but kind of a weird ridge, where actually it is fault. There is like fault line where they actually push together and pushed alongside and kind of slip past one another, giving you this kind of weird mountain range looking thing. This just shows you those crusts, the crust and the mantle. It even shows you the core, the hot outer core, inner core, and it also shows you those convection cells, the way that they move, just similarly like they move in the atmosphere, and showing you those different plate boundaries and what can be formed from those. Great picture to use in the study. Here's the one that your book talks more about. This shows you all the different types of plate boundaries, the major plate boundaries in the Earth. This one, you can see the red are divergent boundaries. They're literally going away from one another. The transform faults are all along those fault lines. So all those lines right there going kind of perpendicular to our divergent boundaries are transform faults. And convergent plate boundaries are the ones represented by this triangle right here. And you can see there's lots of different types of plates, lots of movement. And then you can see that San Andreas Fault, well, there's a bunch of them, right? Kind of, well, there's one of those. It's one of those small lines is the San Andreas Fault over there. All right. So some parts of the Earth's surface actually build up and some wear down. This is known as weathering, at least the wearing down part is. Internal geological processes generally build up the Earth's surface, so we're actually, making it quite, the surface of the Earth, at least the land mass, is much larger. Internal geologic processes are weathering, and those are things that are breaking down the external ones. There's three types, physical, chemical, and biological, and we'll explore what those factors in there in a little bit. This also helps with erosion. Erosion helps with this, which is wind, flowing water, human activities, like mining, all sorts of things that would help with erosion. Glaciers as well actually will erode and then wash if they melt away some of that debris. And here's our three different types of weathering. Biological, which is basically done by tree roots, kind of filtering, kind of breaking down some of that bedrock to get to the nutrients they need. And lichens, literally on the outside of rock and then growing and breaking things down for them a little bit, smaller amounts. Chemical weathering, which is water, acids, bases, gases, kind of changing that rock form and breaking it down. And physical weathering, like the ones you're most familiar with, wind, rain, flowing water, expansion, contraction, freezing, all those break rock down into what we call parent material, which is down here kind of showing you the different ways that weathering can occur. Volcanoes. Volcanoes is always a good topic to talk about. They release molten rock from the Earth's interior, which are, there's three different types of words I want you to look at, which are called fissures, where that's the break, or where lava is seeping out. The magma, which is the kind of when it comes to the surface, and then lava, well, no, magma is below, and then lava is on the top, on the surface, when it reaches there, so it actually gets cooled and then hardened to rock, or igneous rock, which we'll talk about in a minute. There's a couple of major eruptions that you want to learn about and talk about, which I'll show you a few videos below this video, which we'll talk a little bit more about eruptions. In 1980, the eruption of Mount St. Helens. 1991, the eruption of Mount Pinatubo, which impacted the U.S. as well. But we're going to look at a couple videos. I'll point those out down in the YouTube section right underneath this video. And there's also good benefits of volcanic activity, which are many. They, revitalize areas. They return nutrients. Very good for plant growth. They look pretty when they're resting, which gives you some visual aspect of them. They do a lot of different things. They change the environment. They add sulfur in the atmosphere, which is not such the good thing, but there are some benefits. At least with soil nutrients. All right, and your book doesn't really go into all the different types of explosions and volcanic activity. The Barron's book does a little bit, and we'll hit that in a review session. But you can see that these are extinct volcanoes that have already blown. But there's many different types of ways that a volcano can erupt, and that we won't talk about, unfortunately. But fun subject anyway. Earthquakes, another geological rock and roll event. There's lots of different vocabulary for this one. And this week you're going to make t-shirts and kind of hopefully get some of this vocabulary into your t-shirt in a cool artistic way that I know you can do. And one of them is called seismic waves. That's actually the wave at which the reaction of the earthquake is transmitted. The focus and the epicenter, kind of where the actual friction originates from, and the magnitude and amplitude is how we measure earthquakes. But I'm gonna let you guys talk more about that and read more about that in your textbooks. There's also a Richter scale, a way of kind of measuring the event itself. And you can see that above an 8 is a huge, great magnitude of the Richter scale, and destructive and damaging is only at 5. So insignificant. We experienced one of those, I think it was a few years ago, last year or so, where it was like very, very minuscule. We did feel it here. Foreshocks and aftershocks. These are earthquakes that are occurring kind of before or after the major of, or the highest mark as far as the Richter scale goes. And they kind of, you know, allude to bigger quakes or at thereafter. So there are some that happened as well. Major features and events of earthquakes. So here we're going to talk about focus is actually where the friction is taking place. The epicenter is directly above that on the surface of the earth. These are shock waves, which you can see are seismic waves that are basically moving, and that's what you're feeling is moving spread very far distances. And then, so those are some of the major things. Also, they cause landslides, or mudslides, which are very dangerous to people who are living in this area. It would be bad, very bad for them if the mudslide or rock slide did occur. Here are some of the areas that are at highest risk in the United States. Obviously, over here, where all those transform faults are in California. There are a few small transform faults in this region as well of the United States, but there's a couple areas of risk. Overall, the United States, not a huge risk for earthquakes, except for in California and Hawaii. They didn't show that picture either. They kind of threw that one off there. But as far as it goes, compared to other countries, where our country is very, very good. Now you can see a picture of the greatest earthquake risk in the world. You know, obviously we have some on our West Coast, but you know, South America and especially Asia and all those outer islands out in Asia is just way more risk than us. All right, tsunamis, again, caused by friction of the Earth's plates. We call these waves tsunamis because they're huge, but they're not ones you can really surf. Well, I guess you could, but it probably wouldn't end up very, very well for you. But we have detections now since the 2004 Indian Ocean tsunami, which had a magnitude of a 9.15 on the Richter scale. That was the earthquake that caused it, which was huge. And it has major damage, especially the way that's set up. And I'll show another video about that, so check that one out down below as well. And also the role of the coral reefs and mangrove forests. They actually help reduce the death toll because what happens is they slow that wave down. They slow that motion of water down. They kind of slow it before it gets to the surface, which actually causes less damage to the continents. So those are a good thing to have. The problem with that is a lot of people damage the reefs, or they destroy the reefs, and they also destroy mangrove forests to build up big mega complexes and oceanfront property. So that's a big problem, especially it was in this area, which caused some major damage in 2004. And this just kind of shows you what the formation of the tsunami. This is the one in 2004, tsunami in around India and Thailand and Bangladesh. And the reason why it was such a bad one is because it was so central and it hit right there, or that was the epicenter. And then it kind of like, it's shot into this little cove here, I want to call it, of this continent, and basically kind of just wreaked havoc on all those places, on all those beaches and an ocean front on those different countries, those four different, or well, six different countries. This is what happens. It's basically a slip. An earthquake is caused that motions that at least the water mass upward, which surges a wave. And when you see the video that I'm going to show you guys, and I'll put them out on YouTube again below this video today, you'll see what a couple of ones of tsunami videos that you'll see. They don't really look like waves per se, just a mass of water just flowing in there. And I'll show the Japan one that happened a year or two ago as well. And this is in Indonesia, and this is before and after that tsunami in 2004, which was a major disaster for that place. You can see this is the aerial image before, and you can see what's left of it after that tsunami. So the amount of water, and it was because of such a strong earthquake, the amount of water was devastating to that area that came through there. Another one that's caused by earthquakes is mass wasting. We call it that. It's basically called landslides, but we call it mass wasting because it's just stuff, mass that's just flying down a hill, basically, or down an elevation. And sometimes it's slow movement. A lot of times it's fast movement, which is the dangerous ones, like rock slides, avalanches, mudslides. That's just a matter of what material is being used. Rocks for rock slide, snow and ice for avalanches, and mudslides, just liquidy mud. So those are the types of mass wasting that are caused, again, from the jostling of the earth because of plate tectonics, and then causing for those movements down an elevation. And there's lots of effects. When we take down trees in areas, that's a bad thing. And that has that allows those roots usually holding that rock. Well, those roots aren't there, then the mudslides and avalanches and rock slides can occur. All right. And that brings us to the end of our first section. Hope you guys enjoyed it. We'll see you next time.